The rider that we're interviewing today became pro at a young age, and since then, he has done it all. He's won X Games medals and Nor Cup awards, and he's seen by many as the greatest all-around rider to ever do it. Dennis Enarson is respected by all of his peers, both on and off the bike, and he consistently leads by example. So let's sit down with Dennis and talk BMX. So Dennis, you grew up in Southern California, which is the action sports mecca of the world. What was your first BMX memory there?
San Diego had a X Games in Mission Bay in like 1998 and 1999, I think, or 1997 and 1998. One of those early, almost late 90s years. And my mom and dad just randomly took me and my brother because they were like, my parents were always cool, like trying to show us new things, and it was free. So it was like so easy for us just to drive down there. And I saw TJ Lavin win dirt. There was Vert. I didn't really see Park, but I like walked by the Park course. We had no clue what was going on. And honestly, had no, like, we weren't even favoritizing BMX. It just happened that me and my brother kept being like, let's watch that. Like, just kind of followed the bikes around, and we watched the whole dirt finals. And yeah, so the X Games came to San Diego and threw it right in our face.
Oh, that's cool. That's awesome. Yeah. Actually, I remember going to my first X Games, and it was in Philadelphia, and it was just happened to be the year before I entered my first X Games. And Whoa. That was not on my radar at all. Like, Wow. There was not even an option for me to be a professional, like, you know, a year from there. So, like, crazy to think about that. You went to X Games as well.
Yeah, you started really young. So you already were, like, full on riding then, and then the X Games came to you.
Yeah, of course.
That's dope.
So you did start out racing. That was your kind of first step into BMX. How did you transition from being a racer into, I mean, kind of what you are right now?
Well, it was, like I said, my first glimpse of BMX was the X Games. It wasn't racing. And so I like begged for a BMX bike for Christmas, and then my parents got me this BMX bike, and, you know, not talking shit on the parents or anything, they just had no clue. So they got me this bike that was like, I don't even know what it was, a Schwinn with like these weird tube angles, and it was kind of like a flatland bike, and it was dope. I loved it, but I couldn't even bunny hop it up a curb. It was just way too heavy. And then they took us to the racetrack, and I was like, oh, this is sick. I can ride my big old bike. Like, this is somewhere I could go down the hill and, like, actually having fun riding my bike. So then that escalated to getting a nicer bike eventually, and then, like, eventually really getting into it and going to nationals and having a lot of fun with it. But I still had that memory of what freestyle was. And anytime at, like, a national or a big race, there'd be dirt jumps nearby. It was, like, my goal was to just ride the dirt jumps the whole time. And I didn't really even see it as a sign that I like freestyle the most until I was like 13 years old when I started going to the Claremont skate park, because I'd been riding dirt jumps and like was honestly more fixated on the jumps and the tracks. Anytime there was jumps near the track, I was like, I was over here, and the team manager would have to, where's Dennis? You know, like, his races are about to start. I'd be like, oh shoot. And then like was so unfocused, you know, I just wanted to go right back to the dirt jumps. And then that the Claremont skate park opening up and being like 20 minutes from my house, my mom took me there one day with all my skater friends, because I actually wasn't even like fully into freestyle yet. It was like BMX racing and then skater friends. And that was like my life, like skating and BMX racing. And then I found the skate park, bike park, and I was like, whoa, it's a mix of like skateboarding and BMX racing. And I was like hooked as soon as I found that place, because, you know, the Claremont park, it was just massive, and had, I remember going there and doing my first wall ride, and like there was just so many firsts like within the first month of riding there. And it was just like, I remember going to, after like a month of riding there, we went to a national, and I just told my mom like the second day, like, do you mind if I stop racing? And we were at the race, and she was like, yeah, of course. Like, I was kind of wondering when you were going to ask that, you know? So then I just didn't even go back for the Sunday race and went road street with my friends all day. So that was it. I just knew it was like the Claremont skate park pretty much changed what I knew I really liked to ride.
Just like myself, you became pro at a relatively young age. I remember seeing you at the events, though, and you're riding with these top name pros, and you didn't seem to be too fazed by that. Was it overwhelming for you when you first started?
Probably, because I would say no. I was more nervous with how I was going to ride myself, you know, like how everyone gets nervous. I still get a little nervous like that. Like, I just want to ride good and those little butterflies and all that. But I think it was just because of the Claremont skate park. Like, I had these massive ramps that were almost exactly like when I showed up to a Dew Tour. I was like ready to go. Like, the courses were so similar to the park I was riding every day. And then at my local park was like, I would see Gary Young and Steve Woodward and Mike Cleveland would come down. And then randomly, like, you would roll through on a Road Fools. Like, the biggest name pros ever were stopping by Claremont, like, on a weekly, monthly basis. And like, there was already like local exposure tour passing through. I had met all these big pros. And I don't know, it was just kind of like, I was surrounded by it already. And so when I went to the contest, I kind of already knew a bunch of people at like 15 years old. It was crazy. But then I did still, you know, Ryan Nyquist, Dave Mira, like when being on a X Games course when I was like 16 with Dave Mira still, like, that was unreal. Like, I remember that first X Games. Like, Dutour was a little different because it was like everybody, but I remember the first X Games I got invited to at a really young age. That was like my first pro year, I'd say. Like, I did decent in those Dutours and got invited straight to X Games. I was like, X Games? Like, are you serious? Kind of like you. Like, you had no clue it was coming. And then that next year, me and Garrett got invited to X Games, and it was like me, Garrett, the sickest pros ever, and, you know, we're on a deck, and Dave Mira was like right there, like warming up on the course with us. And I was, I couldn't get used to that. That took a second. Like, why am I in the same rank as Dave Mira? Like, this is insane. So I think the Claremont Skate Park, yeah, I think I kind of covered that. And then, but it was still like, I felt comfortable, but there were still times, like, it took a while to, you know, Ryan Nyquist, Dave Mira, like, those names were just too much for me to handle.
Yeah, just legends, man.
Just too legendary. Like, I played them as a video game when I was like a little squirt growing up. Like, and now I'm watching him backflip that 8-foot spine at that, remember that X Games with the rollers and the crazy spine?
That, was crazy.
That course was crazy. The course was overwhelming. The people there were overwhelming. I was like, I think I got last place. Just like, this is crazy. My brother and all our friends just wanted guest passes, so the whole mission was to get as many guest passes as we could. Like, I wasn't really focused at all. It was too much for me.
Your style of riding is unlike any other rider out there. You can ride everything from street to park, from dirt to bowls, and you excel at each of these. What inspired you to ride this way?
Well, thanks for the compliment. But, yeah, I don't know. I think another reason from coming from San Diego is in, like, when I was at that Claremont skate park, well, I already raced, so I had, in dirt jumped, that was like the first chapter of my life, so I feel like dirt was kind of always in my blood, like, from finding lines of the track to flow, and then going to the trails when I was like the littlest kid, you know, and the older friends just hit it, you know, and I'm like, all right. So dirt was like, that always felt like it was in my blood, and then the Claremont skate park was like the sickest skate park in California for those years where I was like, just investing all my time there, literally like every extra second, every extra little bit of time I had was at that skate park. And then just so happened that half the guys there were like full on street riders. So as soon as I started like making friends with everyone, getting rides to and from the skate park, I started going on these little street missions with everyone. So it all just kind of naturally happened where I was just kept riding my bike, and it was almost like a product of my environment. And it's weird because everyone always says that, like, it's crazy how well-rounded you are and everything. And it's always a huge compliment to me, you know? But to me, I never planned on being like Mr. Well-Rounded bike rider guy. I was just riding with all, I had like different groups of friends, you know, the street rider friends, my park friends, all the trail guys. And we all kind of like met at the Claremont skate park. So it was just this, just product of my environment.
Do you wish that riding was less segregated when it comes to guys that are like, oh, I'm only a street rider? Or like kids starting out like, oh yeah, I'm only street, I can't go to the skate park. Like, do you notice that a lot
yeah.
more right now?
And I think it's fine with whatever you want to do, 100%. Like, whatever you want to do, like, do it. But I just always try and promote to new riders and kids that say, like, I can't ride the quarter pipe, you know, I just ride flat. I learned how to ride them flat. And I'm just like, man, you're riding this bike, like there's so much fun things to do. Like don't put yourself in a category so much that you really think you can't ride the dirt jumps or the skate park. Like, I get it. If you just grew up riding in New York your whole life and you never hit a dirt jump, like, hell yeah, that's gonna be intimidating. Same with the trail guy who's never rode pegs. Like, I'm not gonna send him down, tell him like, hit the 16 stair rail. Cause I understand, like, even though I know they're good enough, like on both ends, like it's scary. It takes a while to figure all that out. But yeah, I don't think, I think kids should be a little more open to the idea of just hitting everything. And I feel like the last couple of years, I've noticed it a lot more, like kids grabbing bikes and just being, there's a lot more well-rounded riders than there was, I feel like, a few years ago. There's definitely both ends of it where people are going like totally towards their little niche of BMX and sticking there. And then there's the other end of it where kids are trying to ride a little bit of everything.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. I'd love to see more kids out there riding a little bit more out of their comfort zone, because there is so much in BMX that you can enjoy and get out of it. And if you stay in a bubble like that, like, oh, I can't do that because I'm supposed to be a street rider, it's like you're holding yourself back from not only, you know, expanding your riding, but enjoying yourself riding your bike as well.
And like the street kids maybe being like, oh, we don't really hang out with the park kids. It's like, go with a different crew one day, you know? And like, just enjoy that. You know, there's so much, it's, you have this awesome tool and you're getting good at it. Why not like dabble with a little bit of everything? So you're never going to get bored. And I feel like that's another reason why I kind of rode a little bit of everything, is because I have like, not like crazy, it's hard for me to keep my attention on stuff because it's always been BMX and I've always loved it. But like, if I'm bored of the skate park, then I just go on a street trip and it's like the most refreshing thing ever. It's like a whole different hobby. Like between trails, park and street, it's like, it's all BMX to me, but it's like, I think it's always kept BMX so fresh, because I'll I used to show up to those dirt contests and be like, dude, I haven't rode dirt in so long. But then the dirt contest would get me back into riding dirt. I go home and ride a bunch of dirt. Then I'd be like, man, I'm overriding dirt. And then a couple street trips would come up back to back. I'm like, oh my God, I forgot how fun street is. So it's just been like constant cycle of like riding something for a long time. And then boom, I get sent on these street trips, and then boom, back to Claremont for a month straight. It's just been, it's all been really natural, but it's helped. I mean, I've been doing this for, you know, not as long as you, but pretty long now. And it's just not ever really got boring, because there's always something different to dabble with because of riding everything my whole life.
You also have such a unique bag of tricks. You have triple tail whips and flip whips, and you also have switch tricks and nothing C grab bar spins. What inspired you to go so many different directions when it comes to your tricks?
There was a point there, like when I was saying I was at Claremont every extra second of my life I had, like it was Claremont skate park. And I think just the fact of being there for 8 hours a day and just playing on my bike so much, like all these tricks just came naturally. There wasn't too many tricks where I like thought them over and over in my head again and then went to the park and did them. It was always like learning double bar spins. Like, it was the most random thing ever. I jumped on my friend's bike with a high seat and I was like, oh, perfect, I can finally try double bar spins, you know? And like, and then that just, I never thought I was gonna do double bar spins. Like, now I feel like I'm kind of like the double bar spin guy, aside from Nyquist and a few others. You were getting into double bar spins there for a little bit.
I was.
A sick trick, right?
And like, really,
so many people
are
like, how do you do that? And it's like, dude,
it's terrifying for people to learn. That's the thing.
Terrifying, but once you kind of start flicking them, it's like, just like a bar spin. You just figure out that motion of leaving your hands off a little longer.
Speaking of bar spin, you are so good at doing bar spins both ways. You learned your opposite direction, technically?
Yeah, when I just started bar spinning first over dirt jumps and box jumps and spines or whatever, I throw with my right hand and I'm left foot forward. So technically that's like the wrong way to do a bar spin. But I do everything else normal, which is weird. Like, I'm left foot forward, spin, I'm not goofy footed at all, kick tail helps a normal way. But for some reason, bar spins, I spun with my right hand. And then I remember the first bar air I ever did, I didn't even think about it. I just knew what bar airs look like, threw it with my left hand, and never even thought about it. And then like when I would do a bar wall ride, bar out, I remember that day I was filming that, I did a bar with my left hand in and then bar with my right hand out, not even thinking. And like, I remember Gary was at the skate park that day, and I wasn't really that good friends with Gary yet. He was just like the local pro who would come in and out, and he saw me riding, was like, what the heck, you did a bar to wall ride to opposite bar? And I was like, yeah. I'm like, cool, like I didn't know I could do that, but like, all right, that's what you call an opposite bar. Like, so I just didn't know. I got really lucky with that, and now everyone's like, switch bar, regular bar. I'm like, yeah, sure.
So now, like, when you show up the spots, like, are you even like thinking like about like which direction you're gonna throw the bar spin, like for certain things? Like,
no.
is it almost like whatever feels right?
Yeah, like if I'm going a huge gap, like that big one I did in caps lock, like the biggest bar spin I ever did in my life, like over the curb, down the stairs, into the bridge, I threw with my right hand.
So that was technically an opposite bar spin?
No, that's normal. Was your right hand. Okay. Like, let's say like, that's the like very, very, that's what people, that's my very, very comfortable way. But if I'm like just pedaling, playing around, like barring down a 13 stair where I barely even hop because I don't want the impact to be hard, I'll just throw it with my left hand because it's like less of a bunny hop. When I throw it with my left, I can kind of like hover and just do it like that. But when it's like, all right, go time, I'm really popping and throwing, it's going to be my right hand.
And if you throw it with your right hand, that's...
this is serious usually. Like,
but that would technically be an opposite bar spin, even though...
I don't think so, because for me, it's normal.
But, like, technically...
Technically, I guess.
Yeah, you're like one of the only riders I've ever seen that's been so comfortable both ways, kind of...
It just happened.
Yeah, it just happened.
And not so much with tail-ups... Tail ups and spins were like not like that. It was like one day I was like, I gotta switch spin the box, you know, like that was like a big movement in my riding. But the bar spin thing was always natural. And it's funny, on like Instagram comments, like say I just post like a nose bonk bar over like a wheelchair hop or something, like half the comments would be like, switch bar, you know, like kids give me so much credit for it. And I'm like,
it's the first time I noticed you do it. It was at, it might have been a Dew Tour, I think, and you did a nose bonk bar dropping off of like something pretty big. I'm like, man, he just threw that the opposite direction. And like, and then it hit me. Like, I was like, wow, he does his varsimies both ways. That's when I found it out. So I literally, I fell for it as well. So
been tricking people with that for a long time.
It's cool though.
They're not opposite varsimies. They're just varsimies.
So Dennis, you've accomplished so much in your career. What are you most proud of?
I don't know. There's like not really something that I feel like I'm most proud of. Because I still feel like I don't have that video part that I'm just like, this is the one that I like, just love. Like it feels complete. Like with, I have a couple video parts that I'm very proud of. I really, like, really love them. And I'd say those are like probably my most proud of things, but I still feel like I'm like,
so which one then? Which one do you feel is the most complete that you've done so far?
There's two, and they're like both really complete on their own ways. Like with, what's it called? The first Demolition DVD I filmed for, and like it came out in like 2011, Demolition Last Chance. That one felt like, as like a video part, I got to film for so long. I was filming with my best friend, Christian. So like, we just get in my car and like me, him, Rob Wise and Tate Roskelly, thanks to Brian Castillo, like literally like he'd just pay for gas and we'd go wherever. So we got to film until like, I was done filming like a year before the video was done because they gave us a deadline. And I was like, I'm done. This is my part. Yes. And then they're like, you guys, they basically pushed the deadline back for a whole nother year. And so I got a whole second part. That's why that part's like so long. And you know, now I would have cut a lot of stuff out. It was like that generation where it's just like film everything. But as in riding, like I got everything done that I wanted to do and then a bunch of stuff I never thought I was going to do. So I'm really happy with that. But at the same time, I think me and Christian were both, he was getting really professional in his film game, and me as a street rider, it was like still not really like, I feel like my most mature riding, but I sent it like a motherfucker. Like that's what I was proud of. Like there's stuff in there. I'm like, yes. And then the caps lock part I dropped, like I was really happy with that riding. It was like more of a mature, thought out part. I kind of knew what I wanted to do. And Christian killed it with filming and editing that. But I kind of got a little bit thrown under the bus because I was filming with Mike Mastroni at first. And he had complications with another job where we had to stop filming together. And then Christian like saved the end of the part. So we finished like the last 25% together. So like I really liked that part. But at the same time, it's like, basically Christian saving a video part. So it wasn't like, it still feels kind of not really like what I was looking for. Like I want a part that like I film with one person and we have like a direction and I'm really happy with my riding all in the same package. So I'm still really want one of those. But I'd say that those two video parts are my most proud of things. Like if all the edits and that Markit edit I did in my backyard, like if I had to save, if all my footage went away and I had to save three things as like my little time capsule to like, if I ever have kids or if my brother has kids or something to show the family down the road, like it'd be like those three video parts.
So BMX has changed a lot since you've become pro. The style, the tricks, the bikes. How do you adapt and keep on pushing yourself?
Yeah, the riding has changed a lot. Like when I first got into it, you know, you remember those contest days when like pretty much everyone had a similar style bike and maybe at that time, everyone was a little more adaptable and well-rounded. Like we're saying right now, it's kind of coming back to kids riding a little bit more, but it's so like, you can go like the Fees route and have this little teeny, like light titanium scooter bike. And you go to those contests and you're like, dude, like the street riders don't even know who those people are. And then like those guys can go to a street event right now and like, those guys don't even know who, you know, they might not even know who Lewis Mills is or something to like, you know, every street kid knows who Lewis is, but, and then, you know, like say Bruno goes to a Fees, he has no clue who Justin Dowell is. You know what I mean? Like, it's like, I feel like there's so many different worlds. And back like when I first turned pro, it was like, everyone kind of knew everyone, you know, like maybe not everyone hadn't met each other yet, but I think everyone kind of followed the big picture more. Now it's like, I think BMX is bigger, way bigger than it was. And so there's just people just riding the plazas and there's people in the trails who don't give a damn about the kids at the skate park. And it's just like, I think it's just expanded so big and there's so many different cool avenues of BMX you can choose that people are kind of picking where they want to be and what they want to do.
So how do you adapt and stay relevant, you know, in all of these all at once, riding the same bike setup all throughout? How do you do it?
I think it's just kind of product of what's going on. It's like same with how I started filming video parts. It was like the Nike days, like Mark Losey just started bringing me on trips and filming with Garrett and Nigel. And I was like, well, like I already like street, but I was so ignorant to it. And it was like, I guess I'm riding street all the time now. And that just happened. And even now it's like, if I'm just at home, it'd probably just be riding you know, Claremont and then street on the weekends, but I get sent on these trips and it's like, we're on a street trip. Now you're invited to the Vans Bowl contest. And then all of a sudden, you know, I get invited to a Dirt X Games. It's still just kind of people keep inviting me to ride everything. And I think that's, and I love riding and I try and say yes to as much stuff as I can. So it's just kind of let the, like, BMX train just kind of keeps me going.
So Dennis, you've been known to do some of the craziest tricks out there. In your video parts, you've had some bangers that have blown people's minds. One of my favorite clips that I've ever seen in BMX happens to be one of yours that you did, the final trick of your writing on the wall video, when you did that tail dropping into that concrete bank. Like, that had to have been terrifying for you. Was that the scariest trick you've ever done?
It was one of them. It's like in the top five for sure, like especially at the time. I think now it wouldn't be as scary, you know, like just I've been riding for so much longer now. I think I was like 16 and yeah, I was with Kyle Carlson and I remember finding that ditch on a Nike trip and Nigel got hurt. He like split his chin open. So we ended up going to the hospital and never making it back to it. And Losi sent me out cause he knew like I wanted to tail up into that thing. So he just sent me and Kyle out to go get that whip. And yeah, it was actually, I don't know. I feel like it's just the right timing for the right things. Like it really at the time didn't even feel that scary. It was just like, let's just do it. Like I already know I could do this. Like, but it was like, changing the game for me, as in like biggest drop, like kicking a whip that big. And I knew I could do it, but no one had really done a big whip like that. I don't think people were doing big whips, like, but it was kind of like, I knew I could do it, but I think like, I kind of felt like when other people looked at it, they're like, this kid's suicidal. And I was like, nah, I got this, you know, and it did work out. But I think that's kind of the things you got to just get out of your head. Cause if you know you can do something, you know, you just got to do it. So I think like, aside from the whip and writing on the wall, the other scariest thing I did, like for the time frame, was that bar manual whip from the demolition video that we were talking about, just because it was like the same thing where I got there. And I think everyone was kind of just like, dude, Dennis is, what's wrong with him today? Like he's going to kill himself. But in my head, I was like, I got this, even though I don't really do manual whips too often. I just took my brakes off. You know, I haven't really been doing whips without brakes. And I was just like, when you're riding a big setup like that, you just put like such a crazy 100% in, you know, it's like when you're at the park and you're trying a trick, like, you know, my manual whips might not be every go. I might not kick them every go, but it's like on a spot like that, you just turn it up. It's like, you almost use that, like when a mom gets her kid stuck under a car and they have that like super adrenaline, it's like you get this crazy feeling in you. And that's like one of my favorite things in the world is like, riding, like looking at the spot, turning around, and then when you do that U-turn and you like that crazy, like I'm doing it right here. Like I'm trying as hard as I can. If I fall, at least I'm going for it. And that's like my drug to me is like when you turn it off, do the U-turn and just send it and look back. Like I did that. Like, whoa, that's my favorite thing in bike riding. I love like landing a contest run or, you know, filming a cool tech line, but there's no feeling to me like just sending it and just saying like, I have to tell them, even my brain's telling me no, but like, I really like, there's something in me that knows I can do this and I want to do it. You know, like that's my favorite thing. Even if it's that's why I do really love contests too, because there's kind of that same mode where you're practicing and it's really hard to do a trick. But as soon as they're about to call your name, you're like, I have to do this right now. Like, and that doesn't always happen in every contest, but those good contests with the good vibes and the good setups, like, and you get something done that you just, if it was practice or it was just a normal session back home, you would never have done. Like, I just love that feeling of just the switching it off and like overcoming your brain telling you, don't do this, don't do this, don't do this. So I think that's why I like keep doing big, scary stuff. And like right now working on a video part, it's like, that's kind of all I want to do. It's like, I'm obsessed with it. Just, I'd rather just send tricks and like spend time trying a technical trick, which I love that. I love watching that stuff, but right now in my head, I just want to keep switching it on and doing that.
Cool. No complaints here. I'm excited about it. So Dennis, what's your favorite part about modern day BMX?
My favorite part about modern day BMX is the new modern day riders. I love it. Like there's so much talent coming in to BMX right now. And there's so much talent like underneath that talent, you know, like because I travel so much and I go to so many different events that I constantly get to see like the best new park kids, the best new street kids, you know, I'm like always bumping into this new talent and like talent. You can see talent all over Instagram. That's not, you know, the kids that aren't making parts yet or not sponsored yet. Like that's a cool way of seeing this young talent, but this modern day BMX talent and these new kids, like, you know, the 20-year-olds and then the 15-year-olds and then the little, there's like a 10 and 11-year-olds. Like the talent and the direction the sport's going is just like so amazing to me. I literally think it's like, to me, it's the coolest sport because you can just grab a shovel and be a little redneck kid and make dirt jumps, or you can be blessed to have an amazing park like Claremont or the Incline Club, or you can be grow up in an urban jungle and put four pegs on in a free coaster and just like, there's your park right there, you know? So, and bikes are so good now. I think it's just like this, like BMX is cooler than it's ever been to me. You know, it might be clicky and all over the place with what people really like to do, but it's just, I think that's what's so rad about it. We can ride in the dirt. We can ride in the wooden parks. We can ride in the cement parks that skateboarders build for us, or they build and we get to, yeah, it feels like it. Like, thanks guys. Like another skate park for skaters, and then just gets flooded with bike riders.
So what's something that you would like to change about current day BMX?
Honestly, nothing. I think everything's cool. You know, like there's YouTube kids making it big doing that. There's pro street kids who never have to hit a quarter pipe and that's what they love and they're sponsored for that. There's kids that don't give a damn about being pro and they just got their little scenes going. Due to just, you get to, like, trails are so cool too, because that's like you halfway ride and you halfway are just building art, and then you can go for the Olympics if you want to right now. X Games, you can ride in the Vans bowl contest and not learn a, you don't have to learn a double whip ever, you know, you don't have to tail up. Like Corey Walsh is like running that game right now, and he just keeps it so simple and just straight up bike control. You know, it's like, I wouldn't change anything. You can pick any avenue and just do it. There's, it's like 5 or 10 sports wrapped up into one sport. It's amazing.
Who's your favorite rider of all time, and what about that rider makes him so memorable?
I mean, I could always change it, you know, but like, my favorite rider of all time, I have to say, is Josh Harrington. I have a lot of favorite riders, obviously, everybody does, but Josh Harrington was just like my hero, you know, like he's just, I get a lot of influence from him. He kind of rode everything, you know. He was never really known for a trail guy, but he could just shut down trails. Like he had that skill in his back pocket so easily. I think he just wasn't really exposed to trails as much as he was the ramp scene and the street scene, but fellow tall rider, like it's pretty hard to be a tall rider and just, I don't know, there's a lot of tall riders, but there's a lot of tall riders with good stees. But he always, like, I loved like him and Chris Doyle, because there were like other tall riders that just like kept it looking natural on a bike. And I remember always thinking when I was growing fast, I was like, fuck, I don't want to like look like a super tall awkward rider. And so it was cool to have those inspirations, like these steezy tall guys. But just in a whole grand scheme of things, like the tricks he did were always different. You know, he filmed bangers in the streets, but he also like could show up to a dew tour and just do like make finals doing exactly what he wanted to do and not following the foam pit tricks. And yeah, just a huge inspiration on me. And you could obviously, if you're a Josh Harrington fan, you obviously see where I got a lot of my tricks from. You know, I thought what he was doing was awesome, and I wasn't necessarily trying to copy him. I just was like obsessed with his riding, and it just kind of naturally happened.
So in years to come, when people think back to Dennis Enarson, how would you like to be remembered?
In years to come, as a BMXer, I would be stoked to be remembered as, I don't know, like at this point, I have so much footage, you know, out there, and I've changed in the riding. Like even when I started doing the pro contest, to me, I don't feel like I was a pro, you know. I was still this experimental kid, like figuring out what I really liked. And, you know, now I'm 28 years old, and I feel like I'm coming into understanding with just like the tricks that I love and the kind of riding that I really, really love, whether it's like sending something scary in the streets or if it's a contest. Like I'd rather try and do stuff dialed and in control, and rather than just like hucking a trick that I'm not very good at. And you know, like that's fun too, but like, I don't know, I guess I'd like to just be remembered as someone who just loved riding and like just did it as much as I could until I got to a point where I just like just felt good on my bike every time I grabbed those grips.
For more on Dennis Enarson, you can follow him on Instagram @DennisEnarson, and be sure to check out his podcast, Unclicked. And be sure to check out all of his video parts, and you can find them all on vitalbmx.com.